Hello, my name is Stavros Savvopoulos. I'm from Greece, part of OGS.
And I am Filippos Strekker. I am also from Greece and also from OGS.
Yamamoto from Tokyo, Japan.
So I'm Sebastian and I'm from the United States. I'm an engineering student at Virginia Tech. We're in Taiwan at Asus's headquarters. We've been overclocking the past few days Intel's Raptor Lake refresh, 14th gen.
We have gathered together to have fun, benching the new Intel CPUs, breaking records, testing the new products in general. It runs fine.
I'm Peter Tan. I've been working at Asus for 12 years now. Basically, I'm part of this huge overclocking community. It's a lot to do with performance-driven people, you know, people who want to push their systems and get the most out of their systems and develop into a hobby for most of us. This is one of the events where we get together, focus on a particular platform, and then try to run the best benchmark scores to try to get records and, you know, get the best scores out of the platform.
When we were like 200 milliseconds faster.
Yeah. They are all different characters, right? They come from different culture and all that, but like we all share the same hobby, the same passion for, you know, for overclocking, you know, and benchmarking, seeing the higher numbers, slowly improving the scores and all that. So this is what kind of like the common thing that draws all of us together. It's kind of a tradition here at Asus, and I've been like I've known a lot of them for the longest period of time. Even some of them when they were, you know, still teenagers. Now they are grown adults. Here we have Sebastian from the US, Stavros and Phil from Greece, OGS, and also we have Fredyama San, who's from Japan, whom I've known for a long, long while.
No, nothing here. Virus setting.
I was working almost one third of a year abroad. I'm gonna come back to Japan, try to relax, to build my own PC, just a daily machine. Then many people, Japanese community, has overclockers. So getting more into the overclocking, then started from LN2. In the past, I never visited any manufacturers, but after Peter moved to ROG, then I came quite often come down to this headquarter for benching.
Need to check that everything works, because if it doesn't, we're going to go into that. OGS stands for Overclocked Gaming Systems. It's basically me and Phil benching under that nickname, a bit of a collaboration in a sense as an overclocking team. So I had my father's PC end of 2007. We bought like an expansion card, like a PCI card that kind of gets you Ethernet. And while both of my parents were away, I felt adventurous and I was bored. So I got the card out of the box, I opened the case without knowing what I'm doing basically, figured out how I can plug this into the PC. So I was trying to be cautious because I had no idea what I was doing basically. And then after that, I built my own PC a few months later. And then I started jumping from one motherboard to the other, getting the numbers higher, improving the cooling, and slowly getting into extreme overclocking.
So I have this passion with the flight simulators. So after the Commodore 64 that I used to play some flight simulators, I had to go to serve in the army, where I had access in an office that had a Pentium 1, I think. And I tried to make it a game machine. You know, so I opened it and I added a sound card so I can have sound and add a joystick. So yeah, this was my first contact when touching the hardware of a PC. And later, after the service in the army, I built my first PC. It was also Pentium 2, I think. It was a slot 1 CPU. At 350 megahertz.
No, I'm so close! 93840.
Yeah, you need 600 points.
My first Intel processor that I overclocked was also just my first CPU, which is the i7-7700K. I got it to 5.1 gigahertz for daily stable, and I didn't get into memory overclocking much later, where I got from my memory from 3200 megahertz to 4000. Building your own PC is like, you feel like really smart while doing it, and I want to like keep going to the next level, I guess. Around 2020, I was in a Discord server of people that enjoyed getting like all the leaderboards. I participated in it a lot and I spent a lot of time on it. And eventually, like every winter, we would put our PCs like outside to get as cold as possible. But eventually that became really impractical. And eventually when I had enough money, I got into liquid nitrogen overclocking, water cooling to liquid nitrogen directly, nothing in between.
Extreme overclocking means with below ambient temperatures. So either you use some dry ice or liquid nitrogen or some cooling based on evaporating systems. It can be single stage or dual stage like cascades.
Dry ice is harder in my opinion. It's like, well, harder and like a lot more work. You need to like crush up the dry ice and you have to like pour acetone. It's also just a lot worse. It's like, it's not just the temperature that's worse. Like it doesn't hold temperature under load as well, and it takes a lot longer to get cold. And it's just a mess.
Everybody has a unique ideas to do and then to benching. So I don't know which one is right or wrong. It's up to, you know, their decisions. Yeah. Once I set up, I can run like 12 hours just straight. I've been doing like that for 15 years, same way.
Most of the times it is done with liquid nitrogen. So you have to use a pot.
Obviously like pot is like the CPU container, like it's a copper usually based container that we use. And from there you have to insulate. We use Vaseline, the classic way that a lot of people hate, but it is quite convenient.
Now I spend a lot of time like putting insulation on the board, even though I don't really like Vaseline, which is here, Vaseline is kind of necessary because it's so humid. But at home, just like putting foam in all the crevices is good enough.
We still use a bit of like nail polish for some of the parts, like controllers or fuses, USB fuses and so on. Basically, before insulating the motherboard with the Vaseline, we have to prepare the USB fuses to avoid having issues, because for whatever reason, they react with the Vaseline and break. And this suits an error called USB overcurrent every time you go to the BIOS, basically. And the motherboard shuts down after 10 seconds, so it's pretty much unusable. So we have a couple of here, one in here. Sometimes we usually have some on the bottom USB headers. There are two here as well. Then we have a heater on the backplate. Most of the time, either it's GPU or CPU, like a motherboard. A bit of like towel, napkins, whatever we can get in
for
there
for condensation.
Condensation, like for the humidity and everything.
I like using a lot of towels. I know some people like shop towel. I like the normal towels because they take up a lot more like space on the board. And it doesn't just dry up the water, but also just like covers the entire board with something so that water can't like jump out. Like when you pour it into, a lot of like ice jumps out and it lands on the board and melts. But if you just cover everything in towel, then no matter where it jumps, it gets dry. And as for how I like pour LN2, I figured like there's no point running like sort of warm or like something in between, because then you like risk degrading the CPU, not running as cold as possible. So I always just go for as cold as possible. Though that only really works on CPUs. On GPUs, you really do have to take your time, like do like negative 80, then negative 90, then negative 100.
Along the way, you know, you sort of get more interested in overclocking. And it used to be that I overclocked for gaming, right? Gaming was my main purpose. So I overclocked so that I could game better and enjoy gaming better. But eventually it grew to become that I enjoy overclocking over gaming.
I'm still a gamer, but yeah.
But I don't have the time to game because my everyday job is a motorcycle mechanic. I have family, I have a kid. So we meet 3 days in a week for the evenings.
Yeah, we have 3 dedicated evenings a week basically that we go in, test things, break records.
So this is my free time.
Yeah, and back to life after that.
We ourselves, a lot of times, we know that we don't have the right answers, but we want to ask each other for opinions, you know.
Might ask for an image of that.
Let's see.
It all really started when I qualified for the G-Scale OC World Cup. And, well, I won somehow. But it wasn't really somehow, because what I noticed is that it's a lot more of a mind game than just like how good your overclock is. You really have to manage your time really well and not like crack under pressure, I guess. Really the key to winning that was just like being extremely prepared, knowing exactly what's gonna happen and having like a backup overclock in case it's like the one you plan is unstable. Once I won that, of course, a lot of people started talking to me. I got a lot more like friends at like Asus and Intel. And well, they asked me to come here to overclock the refresh CPUs for the instrument.
Record? No, I don't think so. No? Yeah.
Similar. Okay. Super Pi is developed by Tokyo University student and also teacher for Fujitsu's supercomputer at that time. So they tried to measure 32 million digit of a Pi to evaluate their supercomputer at that time. But now, the supercomputer then is now just your desktop. When I started, 32 million digit took me about 2 hours to complete. I just started and go outside, shopping, and come back, finished. The with this refresh one, I got 3 minutes, 5 seconds, 288 or something. It's getting better and better. Yeah. Shorter, it's amazing, you know, like 2 hours, 3 hours in the past, now 3 minutes.
I used LM2 mode, is that okay?
Reptilic really surprised me with the frequency uplift it offered. And Reptilic Refresh is an enhancement of that, offers a little bit more frequency with the same familiarity and a platform that is already very matured. So if you want to just have an easy to set up overclock system, then yeah, it's a good option.
I think it's very important to stay enthusiastic about what you do and don't go upset when things don't work. Basically keep going, keep learning, listen to what other people have to offer. Take experience, take tweaks, take knowledge.
Almost every single thing I do is like because something went wrong doing it in the past, or like not doing that in the past led to something bad happening. And I feel like that's the best way to learn, even for this. Like that's true for so many things, in class, in like life, I guess too. But even for overclocking, like failure is the best way to learn.
As far as overclocking, I don't think age is significant. When I started, I was 55 or something like that. Now when I tried to benching, I'm feel younger.
I think it's just like keep spending a lot of time with people, learn from them, be friendly to everyone, and they'll give you tips.
Friends around us don't really know what we are doing a lot of times, right? It's not a very usual hobby for a lot of people, so it's a rare chance for all of us to actually interact, you know, in person with people who share the same interests.